Rassica's here. So, while I was poking around on a Japanese ebook website looking for info on a certain issue of Famitsu magazine, I searched up Splatoon and came across this. A magazine called Nintendo Dream, and on the cover of an issue that focused on Octo Expansion, a mention of a Q&A with the Squid Research Lab. Now, I have looked around extensively for Splatoon developer interviews related to the game's lore, and I thought I had found them all, but I had never heard of this one. And I poked around online, and I couldn't find any info on what the contents of this interview contained. No scans, no transcription online, nothing. The only option was to either hope someone out there had this magazine, or to take the plunge and spend $8 to get the ebook. I was worried this interview wouldn't have anything new, so I was hesitant to buy it, but thankfully I didn't have to wait long to get access to this magazine, and I dropped everything and went straight to translating it. To my surprise, there is some really interesting info here that I have never seen elsewhere. More info about the professor's motives, sanitization, sea cucumber, and to my surprise, even more lore about dead fish. Before I dive in, I want to give a huge thanks to Judas at Ramdragons for straight up buying this magazine for me and making this video possible. They even made this issue of Nintendo Dream magazine accessible to all on archive.org, and I'll be putting a link to that in the description. So I'm going to go through every question one by one and give my thoughts about it. The first question made me know this interview was going to be good because they went straight into talking about the Octarian military. The interviewer asks, Marina's career went from joining Slimeskin Garrison and specializing in improving the Great Octo Weapons, to being assigned to the Wasabi Supply Unit of DJ Octavio, which is quite a different department, but is this a demotion or a promotion? The answer given was, although it's called a supply unit, it's a position that only elites can take, as it is a unit directly subordinate to DJ Octavio that watches and supports him as he DJs. I don't think we ever got information before on exactly what the Wasabi supply unit was, but now we know that she really was working directly under Octavio. And for the sake of sharing everything, the caption under this image reads, "This is a flutter, designed by Marina during the time she was an elite octoling. A fearsome weapon that automatically tracks its target and fills it with ink. Its sturdiness is also noteworthy." Next question. Looking at the memcake for Marina, it seems that Agent 8 has known her for a long time. Were they acquainted with each other? Marina was a renowned genius in the Octarian world, and she had the respect of many. They weren't acquaintances, as Agent 8 was just a trainee. They just knew of Marina one way or another. And the image captions show evidence of this in-game, saying, "From the conversations and chats, it seems that Marina at least didn't know about Agent 8. But the other caption references a piece of info that was in the Japanese version of Marina's memcake poem. For Agent 8, Marina seemed to be so familiar to them that they recognized her immediately just by her voice." If I recall correctly, a question something along these lines was asked before in another interview, but still, that's a cute thing to note that when Marina was in contact with 8, it was probably thinking like, oh my god, it's that really cool genius octoling that disappeared one day, oh my god. Agent 8 doesn't talk like that. The next question is, I heard that memcakes are kneaded up memories from Agent 8, but what exactly are they? Memcakes are a reward that test subjects receive as proof of clearing each stage in Kamabo Corporation's experimental facility. The memories of the test subjects are extracted and kneaded into a tangible object that can be collected. After collecting the four things, the test subjects get carefully preserved as they have proven their existence to the world. They are ultimately kneaded into a paste, losing their original form and consciousness, and thus becoming one with existence. So, in Tartar's eyes, becoming blended up and part of this pasty slurry of dead test subjects is the ultimate proof of one's existence, as it shows some part of them is worth being preserved in the new world it wanted to create. This interview will clarify more of Tartar's motives later on. The caption here reads, "There are a total of 80 types of memcakes. If you can get them all back in a complete form, you will be a battle master." Next question. Seeing that the deep sea denizens are using the metro, do the deep sea metro stations function as normal stations in addition to holding the challenges? Yes. The deep sea metro is a sort of corporate city centered around the huge facilities of Kamabo Corporation. It serves not only to the residents who commute to Kamaboko, but also the residents who live in the area. And the caption reads, "Normally the train is used for commuting to work and school. It seems that Agent 8 and the others are the irregular passengers here." This info was for sure mentioned in another Japanese interview, but when I posted this translation, I found that there were some people that were not aware of this, so I'm glad to be able to share it now. Tying into the fact that the deep sea creatures are the normal passengers that are doing normal things, there's a tidbit mentioned in Haikata Walker that all the doors in the deep sea metro are larger for the sake of accommodating these huge species. These next two questions are closely connected, so I'm just going to read both of them before giving my thoughts. What kind of everyday activities does Isopadre do? He gives off this feeling of being someone out of the ordinary. Isopadre is on a never-ending journey on the deep sea metro. He got on the train because he wanted to go somewhere, but he is still searching, not knowing if the journey itself was the goal, or if there's a station somewhere to get off. In the midst of all this, he feels a light that he has never seen before in Agent 8 and Captain Cuttlefish, a clear purpose of going to the surface, and that is something Isopadre finds fascinating. After Agent 8 and the others made it to the surface, I think that Isopadre could also go to the surface where he had longed to go if he wanted to. But why do we not see him doing just that? I believe that Isopadre has his own intentions. That's why he did not go to the surface with Agent 8 and the others. When longing and purpose coincide, what remains after reaching the goal? With this in mind, even now Isopadre continues to ride the metro to find his purpose. The caption reads, "Isopadre shows himself as one who seeks the way." Recently, he seems to have taken an interest in rap as well. And he says here, "Don't expect practicality in your collection." Being completely honest here, I do not care whether or not the Squid Sisters are off the hook come back in the future. All I want is Isopadre to come back and get off that train. Please. I think it'd be cool if he does find a purpose and becomes plot relevant, or just finds a place on the surface that we can see him at. And I guess the fact that he doesn't get off the train even after you beat Octo Expansion is also supposed to be for gameplay purposes, because otherwise for many players he would have left the train before you could collect all the rewards from him. Now this next question asks about information given in a specific piece of concept art of Sea Cucumber, shown on page 6 of the Haikata Walker art book. Oh, here it is. It mentions how his body looks mysterious like the universe, shows some other potential alternate designs, and says that Pearl can't tolerate him, but the Octoling does not mind. There's some more notes here, which is where it starts to get interesting, stating that Sea Cucumber is a life form created for the purpose of running the subway, and that there are many of them. This is what gets questioned. According to a piece of artwork, Sea Cucumber is a created life form, and there seems to be more than one. The answer given is that conductors are required to be flexible and able to handle a variety of things necessary in order to keep the deep sea metro in operation. Sea cucumbers are very flexible, so for this reason they were deemed the best choice. The sea cucumbers at each station may look the same, but they are actually different. You can see them being relatively relaxed when they're waiting, so please take a look at the conductors right after you enter each station. This, unfortunately, doesn't really clarify much on CQ being created, but it does give us a surprising piece of info. The whole time in Octo Expansion, you are not guided by one sea cucumber. There is a different sea cucumber at every station, and they all just look identical. I think part of what makes this surprising is the name Sea Cucumber just looks like a punny name of one guy. And it looks like many other languages do something similar, except in Japanese, where they are all just called Namako Shasho, Conductor Sea Cucumber, which sounds more like a generic title rather than a proper name. That info just makes it more believable that it's not just one little guy following you around. And thinking about it even more, you make transfers to other train lines and remember that these are normal trains that also carry normal passengers. You, the player, are not the only one using these trains. While you are on line A, these other lines are still in operation, taking these girls to school, or these dogfish to work, or these sea angels to football practice. But if CQ is with you, who's conducting these other trains? Well, there's our answer. Just one of several dozen other sea cucumbers. This next question, very interesting stuff. It seems that sanitization means more than just cleansing. What exactly happens to the sanitized Octarians? Sanitization is to purge life's energies so that they no longer cause unnecessary hesitation and instability in the mind, and to become part of the loyal Kamabo Corporation. It is said that Deadfish wanted to be partially sanitized so that she could give up her doubts and conflicts about production and devote herself entirely to music. The caption reads, "Deadfish, the active DJ who is also sanitized." Okay, I have a lot to say about this. First, I will say I was really excited when I first read this, and I've seen others going nuts over this info too. Yes, Deadfish wanted to be sanitized. I think many of us have been under the assumption that all of these sanitized Octarians were sanitized against their will, like as a punishment, because all we've heard about sanitization so far is that it causes a loss of free will, gives them no signs of life, and makes them essentially a zombie. Like, who would want that? But I think this is the first time we've ever heard an explanation of sanitization that not only highlights why it could be seen as a good thing, but also shows that there are those who seek to be sanitized because of those reasons. Deadfish, and presumably some of these other Octarians, heard somehow that, oh, there's a procedure to make it so you no longer hesitate over things and put you in a mindset where you can just do things, like, sign me up. But for real, this is a valuable piece of insight on Deadfish as a character, and I've already seen people speculating how this could tie into the names of her songs. Like, what if Regret is about her regretting being sanitized? I've also seen people put forth the idea that the songs, when put in order, is basically her giving her life story. In terms of whether this is the developer's intent when naming her songs, I really don't think the devs thought that far into it. I think they would have been ordered in a way that was actively trying to tell a story if that was really the intent. And we already know from sound director Toru Nigishi that they were named after the vibe that the song gives off, or the kind of gameplay the song goes with. But if you want to headcanon and analyze Deadfish in that way, go nuts, because I really don't expect we'll get an official answer on this minor Splatoon character. Another insight this answer gives us is that Deadfish agreed to be partially sanitized, which shows that partial sanitization is a thing. And hey, maybe that's why her tentacles have a bit of red on them. Her description says that little of her former self remains, which doesn't mean none. So perhaps her not being sanitized completely is why she has that little bit of herself, and why she's still out making and performing music in the deep sea. Question: what is the purpose of Kamaboko turning Octarians that complete the challenge into a paste? The Kamabo Corporation analyzed the reasons for the extinction of the human race, and identified that the cause was the desire to fight with others. They believed that by analyzing the data of each individual through experimentation, and combining all of the best individuals together, they could eliminate the general idea of the individual, and from there, a new life form could be created, and a harmonious world would be born. Now, before we had a pretty decent idea of the true goals of Kamaboko just based on Tartar's dialogue, but I don't think it's ever been laid out in such a straightforward, no-doubts way. And especially the whole eliminating the idea of the individual, I don't think we've seen that phrasing before. Question: what kind of person was the professor that Commander Tartar talks about, the one who created it 12,000 years ago? Is there any connection between it and the professor who created Judd and Little Judd 12,000 years ago? The professor was worried about the loss of mankind due to its own mistakes, and he wanted to help intelligent life that would appear later so that they would not make the same mistakes as humanity. He did so by leaving behind the results of his research and artificial intelligence. He is the same professor who left behind Judd. for those in the future, he left Judd to carry the warmth of life, and at the same time, he left an artificial intelligence to think logically and correctly. Judd and the telephone, both with the same immortal life, and are two who have been watching ink battles for a very long time. Caption reads, Judd, Lil Judd, and the Professor are discussed in the Sunken Scrolls. Something I really like that's brought up here is that we know now the Professor had a specific reason for leaving behind Judd, more than just, like, oh, he liked his cat a lot. He wanted these future species to have a creature to represent the warmth of life, and I think this fact has a lot more weight with the knowledge that mammals are extinct, leaving the Judds to be the last furry, warm-blooded mammals to exist on Earth. There's actually another little bit in this same magazine where the writers speculate that the reason Tartar's intention became so murderous is because, unlike the Professor who programmed it, Tartar didn't know the warmth of life, aka Judd, to keep its sense of, for a lack of a better word, humanity. And in case you missed the memo, yes, Judd is immortal. As stated in the second art book, he was injected with an immortality serum. So, what's so special about the fluorescent green substance common to brainwashed Agent 3, the sanitized Octarians, and Commander Tartar? Answer is, it's a blended ink, and I think it looks like it has a marbled pattern. If you bathe in that ink for a long time, your head will be repainted with Kamaboko's ideas. And the caption reads, Commander Tartar's whole body seems to be stained with the thoughts of Kamaboko Corporation. So being in sanitized ink for a long time leads to having one's mind repainted with Kamaboko's ideas. That makes sense. There is a piece of concept art that seems to line up with this, showing an Octo Trooper getting doused in sanitized ink by Flutter, being the cause of its sanitization. The passage says that when brought under this machine, the Octarians become blue with black eyes and suddenly lose all their memories at once in a terrible spectacle. What this is getting me thinking about is how Agent 3, or even 8, didn't get sanitized despite their exposure to this ink, yet here it shows some Octarians getting completely sanitized with a quick shower. While the passage also mentions that only these normal, common Octarians get sanitized immediately when showered in the ink, I think it's safe to assume by common Octarians they mean like Octo Troopers and Octo Coppers and not Octolings, as pretty much every time you have to fight one in single player, they're given special focus. So this is making me believe that there must be a different process for sanitization of Octolings or even Inklings if that's possible. My theories are it either takes a much longer, deliberate exposure to the ink, or perhaps these IV sets or some kind of proper injection is necessary for Inklings and Octolings to be sanitized, as their bodies are more complicated than your common severed tentacle Octo Trooper. So the next and final question, why does Commander Tartar take the form of a telephone? The answer given is that the diligent Octarians recognize as friends those who look and act like them. That's why it takes the form of an old telephone, whose face is similar to that of an octopus. Incidentally, in the previous game, Captain Cuttlefish was able to investigate the Octarian army for many years because the Octarians thought he was an ally. Okay, I do think it is pretty funny that Captain Cuttlefish was able to dupe the Octarians for so long since he does have this bug-eyed Octarian-esque face. Like, I didn't even think about that. But what I want to talk about here is, so if Tartar looks like a phone because that gives it an appearance that appeals to the Octarians, does that mean Tartar chose this appearance and that maybe it didn't always look like a phone? And if so, what does Tartar really look like? Our two options here is that the Professor coincidentally built this AI into an old phone, which wound up being convenient for Tartar millennia later, or Tartar modified itself to look like a phone. I think this latter concept is really interesting, and taking a look at some concept art, it could be plausible. There's these early-looking concepts with a human brain motif, like this one of what's probably supposed to be Tartar, actually looking like a human brain with an eye, but with how machine-like Tartar is in the final game, I definitely don't think these are canon, but still cool. There's also these other concepts, however, that feel closer to the tartar we got as the final product, and they show a black orb with a glowing red dot. For a long time, I just assumed that this was supposed to resemble a glowing red eye, and I didn't give it a second thought. But looking at this concept here actually shows the orb emerging from the phone body. Is this Tartar's true form? Well, again, this is still just concept art, but I think it does show, possibly, that the devs were toying with the idea of showing that the phone body just serves as an outer husk, and maybe he didn't always look like that. So that's the end of the interview and my thoughts on it for now. I know I dumped a lot of information here just for the sake of covering this entire interview, so odds are in the near future I'll condense some of this info into a more easily digestible form, so be on the lookout for that. Anyways, thank you very much to my patrons for your direct support, and thank you guys for watching. I will see you next time.